Hello, everyone. Welcome to Got OER, a success model for the implementation of open educational resources. My name is Angie Dodson, and I have been an educator for over 21 years, with 15 of those spent in the secondary classroom as a social sciences teacher, and the last six as an instructional designer, where I have created lesson plans for the Army Medical School, developed corporate training, and now am equipping and supporting faculty in the development of their courses at the University of Colorado at Colorado Springs. So as my first endeavor at UCCS, I was tasked with raising faculty awareness about OER and then equipping and supporting them in its implementation. And this is how the OER Success Model was born. So the purpose of sharing the OER Success Model with you today is twofold. To first provide a framework for those of you who may be in a similar situation, and also as a set of guidelines for those of you who are pursuing OER on your own. So let's dive a little deeper. Let's begin with an overview of the model itself. I've used an acrostic of the word success, with each letter representing the steps for successfully implementing OER. The first S initiates the OER journey. Start with the five W's, not R's, of OER, or the essential questions about OER. What are OER? In what ways are they used? Why are they important? Who benefits from them? And where can they be located? Answers to these questions build the foundation for OER use and implementation. The U stands for Use OER Repositories and equips for an effective search of OER. The first C represents Choose Relevant OER and guides the selection of OER based on teaching style, course content, and student needs. The second C, Customize Relevant OER, encourages the application of the actual five R's to develop more relevant, accessible, and inclusive content. The E, or Educate Others, emphasizes strategies for OER advocacy amongst educators, students, and/or throughout an institutional community. The second S, or Survey Student Impact, suggests ways of tracking the use and effectiveness of the OER. And finally, the last S suggests ways to seek internal or external assistance and encourages the sharing out of individual efforts, strategies, and finds to contribute to and grow the OER community. With an overview of the OER success model in mind, let's explore the ways each component may be utilized as a framework for an OER initiative and as guidelines for individual OER implementation. Making it known that OER are available in multiple formats offers a gradual transition of OER implementation if there is not a textbook available, if there are gaps in curriculum that need to be filled, if there is a desire for OER curation or creation, and if time restraints exist. Knowing the five R's, as coined by David Wiley, and ways licensed OER can or cannot be used together ensure that OER are retained, reused, revised, remixed, and redistributed correctly. The BC Campus Open Education Faculty OER Toolkit and the Creative Commons website contain resources to explain the ways OER are used properly. Considering why OER are important to education and which of those reasons are most important to you, the department, or the institution as a whole, assist in casting the vision and setting specific goals for their use. Targeting courses with high or diverse enrollment, high drop, withdrawal, or failure rates, and/or expensive textbooks is an effective way of doing this. Another way is to focus on who benefits from OER, discussing how students, teachers, and faculty all benefit from the use of OER provides the driving force for meeting established goals and fulfilling the vision. Focusing on what matters to you, the students, the department, and the institution as a whole can also help determine where OER are incorporated. When determining where OER should be used, it is important to identify areas of a program or course that are most conducive for their implementation. Examine what curriculum or learning materials are currently used and the formats, the degree to which they are used, the cost, and potential resource alternatives. Analyze how instructional style may influence OER implementation. For more lecture-based styles, consider replacing the textbook based on cost and utilization of the content, or adding multimedia sources for more accessibility and engagement. For more group-based, activity-based, demonstration-based, or interest-based styles, consider replacing multimedia sources based on accessibility and availability, and the textbooks, if used, based on cost, utilization, and accessibility, and adding aspects of OER courses based on accessibility or other student needs. Consider using OER for required courses and ones with high or low enrollments, high DFW rates, based on the cost, utilization, and accessibility of the textbook, and consider replacing it with open e-text, scholarly articles, and multimedia resources. For courses with more diverse populations, utilize OER to decrease the cost and increase the accessibility, the perspectives represented within the content, and the formats of the current learning material. For online courses, assess use of OER based on the accessibility and availability, utilization, and cost of the learning material. Emphasis for in-person courses follows suit, with cost, utilization, and accessibility of course material being the determining factors of where OER are implemented. Once the foundation for OER implementation is established through the 5 W's, the quest for these resources begins. Because locating specific OER can be an overwhelming and time-consuming process, streamline this process through making a collection of OER sources. Begin with your institution's library. Does it offer the resource lists or library guides for OER? If not, identify who might be able to assist with that process. Another option is to utilize the same from other institutions. Creating an extensive OER repository list that can be readily distributed is also an effective way for assisting in the OER search process. Here are examples of both a higher ed and a secondary level OER collection. Once a collection of resources is made, the next step is to provide ways to effectively search those resources and successfully find relevant OER. Using a scavenger hunt composed of scenarios that encourage participants to use different OER repositories and locate different types of OER is a strategy that I find works very well. In their hunt, participants search for a TED Talk addressing collaboration, field-specific scholarly articles using the Google Scholar Creative Commons search option, and the Directory of Open Access Journals advanced search option. The next scenario involves finding a subject or a topic-specific case study using Merlot and OER Commons. This is followed by a scenario requesting them to put together an e-learning series on plagiarism composed of modules, work samples, and tutorials from Hippocampus, OER Commons, and Merlot. Then the next scenario tasks them to find an ebook that could potentially be used in their course. And then the final scenario challenges them to find a specific OER source using another institution's OER repository collection. This strategy teaches participants how to search and to find types of OER effectively and successfully, and creates additional collections of resources as well, while minimizing the challenge of locating specific OER, which brings us to the next part of this model component, fleshing out the good, the bad, and the ugly of OER. It is not unusual for individuals to have reservations about OER. An interesting way to address potential concerns about OER is to conduct a bit of OER myth-busting. The OER myth-busting site tackles common myths about OER by providing facts that counter misconceptions about them. Creating an activity around OER myth-busting can instill confidence and solidify rationale for using OER while bringing out their good. A realistic truth about OER is that they may or may not offer quality components. For these reasons, it is important to incorporate an evaluation process. Because there are different OER types and formats that warrant specific evaluation criteria, different OER evaluation rubrics should be examined to ensure that OER that is chosen meets academic standards. When initiating OER selection, those implementing OER should initially determine to what degree OER will be used as course content. Is the current textbook being replaced? Are OER being used to enhance the representation and/or diversity of the content? Or are they being used to supplement existing material? Then they should pinpoint gaps in existing content OER can fill, and finally assess how well potential OER align with course outcomes. They should also identify their instructional style, prioritize their reasons for OER use, and consider multiple formats that exist in the current content and what OER offers to diversify it. With a lecture-based style, encourage pinpointing the relationship between lectures and the required learning material. If the lectures reinforce what students are reading in a textbook, choose OER to replace more expensive textbooks. If lectures are designed for more concentrated focuses of subject matter, then direct choices of OER that offer multiple perspectives and provide more diverse visual components. For group-based and activity-based styles, there may be more content dependency, so the focus should be on selecting OER that are readily available, accessible, contain multiple perspectives, with an emphasis on specific topics. Because more demonstration-based styles tend to concentrate on specific parts of the content, choices should be on different OER formats to meet the needs of various learning preferences. Instructional style, along with why OER are being incorporated, contribute to relevant choices as well. Lowering textbook cost as a priority points to choosing OER that can replace it. If the text is not expensive, then maybe the focus shifts on selecting OER that increases student engagement and interaction. And if existing content is not accessible, choosing OER to make it so is the most relevant choice, especially when OER offer content in various formats. Making sure OER selections contribute to varying formats of content representation is more inclusive for students and may lead to a more engaging learning experience, as they can offer variation in how information is presented, represent different learning preferences, and may also be more accessible for some students. Another part to choosing relevant OER is encouraging that OER be selected based on student need. Initiate a deeper analysis of the course dynamic to reveal more about the needs of students. With higher enrollment classes, students need easy access to learning material, and there is a wider variety of learning preferences represented, so selecting various types of OER is beneficial. If the DFW rates of the course are high, choosing OER that is again varied in type with no cost streamlines the content or offers tutorials to help build and reinforce prior knowledge, could all assist in meeting the DFW challenge. Examining the level of engagement with current content is also a meaningful strategy. Do students obtain and read the current material? Is the learning material meaningful and relevant and offer multiple perspectives about the subject matter? Does it present information in a variety of ways that engage learners? Answers to these questions can help further direct OER choices. Facilitating a more proactive approach to meeting individual needs can also speak into choosing relevant OER. Does the OER represent diversity? Is it designed with accessibility in mind? Providing checklists and tools for assessing the inclusion and accessibility of the OER can also result in picking relevant OER. One of the other truths about OER is that OER may or may not be totally up to date or relevant. In this stage of the model, it is important to initiate strategies for validating any links within the chosen OER and suggestions for handling broken links, such as notifying the author by placing a comment within the repository in which the OER is found, searching for alternative linked resources, or the removal of those links within the confines of the Creative Commons license. Encourage editing OER for the most up-to-date theory and practice, and revising or remixing the content according to designated Creative Commons licenses. Suggest checking OER for digital relevancy based on current educational trends and evidence-based practices and tools. Point to selecting OER that represent and develop 21st century skills. The next part of the model component, Customize the OER, is to initiate the assessment of how OER contribute to accessibility and inclusiveness. So in addition to assessing retained and reused OER for relevance, ensuring OER content builds on students' prior knowledge and experiences, customizing retained and reused OER to reflect diversity, evaluating OER formats and applications for web content accessibility guidelines compliance, all work together to help succeed in OER access. Putting together guidelines for deciding when it is best to revise and remix OER and when to replace them is very helpful. Here's an example for deciding when to keep or replace inaccessible OER based on OER type. Because students may be participating in the implementation of OER at various stages, establishing options to educate students about OER helps prepare and equip both the instructor and the student for their use. Share strategies for raising student awareness about OER, including a How to Inform Students About OER section. This may include promoting the use of OER in a course description, the bookstore, a profile page as a part of a course introduction, creating an OER awareness micro module, pre-assessing student knowledge about and their experience with OER, and seeking student feedback about OER used in the course. Remind instructors to predetermine how students are utilizing OER and share the rationale and instructions for using them. Suggest that students make great contributors to OER and may be utilized in the 5 R's of OER. Offer ways students can become OER creators of renewable instead of disposable assignments and how they may transition to open pedagogy. Encourage the development of OER student advocacy by offering ways to get the process started, pinpointing the students that are interested in promoting OER, determining how they can plug into existing OER promotional activities, and ways of equipping them for advocacy. Next, create opportunities to equip teachers and faculty members to implement OER, which would include training opportunities, offering a program based on the OER success model, networking opportunities, coordinate with institutional libraries, organizations, and even OER hubs or groups, funding opportunities, secure funding through institutional or educational grants. And finally, badging opportunities. Utilize micro-credentials as a non-monetary incentive. The final component is to promote OER through the institution. Use library OER website pages, faculty support website pages, course catalog and bookstore listings, and faculty orientation, pre-service, and continuous learning events for this promotion. The next part of the model, survey student impact, is to create standard pre- and post-course surveys. The pre-course survey questions should inquire what is known about OER, the experience students have using OER, the quality of previously used OER, and then the perceptions about OER use. The post-course survey questions should inquire about the type and purpose of OER use, revisit the inquiry about the quality of the OER used, the most favorable part of the OER, and then the desires for future use of OER. And this question helps you be able to pinpoint who might be your student advocates. The next part of this model component is to track enrollment and DFW rate. Determine the course enrollment average pre-OER implementation, track post-OER enrollment, and then adjust for the enrollment variables. Establish a similar process for tracking DFW rates. So the final way to survey student impact would be to track engagement and performance rates. Assess attendance, activity participation, and assignment completion rates, as well as grades for each, as applicable for course pre-OER implementation. Track attendance, activity participation, and assignment completion rates, as well as applicable grades post-OER implementation. Account for instructional modes and other variables. And then target engagement questions and utilize responses from formal or informal course evaluations. So the last part of the model includes pinpointing common OER issues and identifying who can help. Then initiate and support the OER design and development process where creators cast their vision for their published OER, compare medium tools for housing their OER, and then map out a process for creating, editing, and then publishing their OER. OER advocacy includes contributing to the OER community, equipping others in their OER pursuits, sharing OER sources, strategies, creations, and successes through professional development and continuous learning opportunities, institution-wide communications, and web pages raises OER awareness, promotes their use, and strengthens their impact. Creating an institution-wide OERMS teams where OER users, adopters, and creators share their finds, creations, and support one another can build and strengthen the campus OER network. Participation in local, state, and national OER events and/or OER Commons groups or hubs furthers networking and sharing opportunities while expanding the OER community. Now that you have been introduced to the OER Success Model as a framework, follow its components to begin or continue in your OER journey. Determine the starting point. Gather all the necessary resources you will be using. Choose the path that most supports your OER journey, whether that's developing an OER initiative or program, creating OER resource collections, or implementing, curating, or even creating OER. Customize the path to meet your OER goals, and then seek the necessary assistance for continued OER success. Please utilize the preceding contact information to reach out to me via email or MS Teams for an OER consultation, OER program tour, or more specific information. You can also explore the links to the UCCS OER LibGuides and the OER Success Program brochure for additional information. I thank you so much for your time and attention, and wish you great OER success.